once. Start at the beginning. The history of Norway has been influenced to an extraordinary degree by the terrain and the climate of the region. About 10,000 BC, following the retreat of the great inland ice sheets, the earliest inhabitants migrated north into the territory which is now Norway. They traveled steadily northwards along the coastal areas warmed by the Gulf Stream, where life was more bearable. In order to survive, they fished and hunted reindeer. And between 5,000 and 4,000 BC, the earliest agricultural settlements appeared around the Oslo Fjord. Gradually, between 1500 BC and 500 BC, these agricultural settlements spread into the southern areas of Norway, whilst the inhabitants of the northern regions continued to hunt and fish. Hunt and fish. The Neolithic period started around 4000 BC. The migration period caused the first chieftains to take control and the first defenses to be made. From the last decades of the 8th century, Norwegians started expanding across the sea to the British Isles, and later Iceland, then Greenland. The Viking Age also saw the unification of the country. Christianization then took place during the 11th century, and Nidaros became an archdiocese, a population that expanded quickly until about 1349, the year of the Dance with the Death. This is so interesting because I was just reading another part of this book about that. The year 1348 was actually one of the most widely spread times of plague in medieval Europe. Yeah, it says here the Middle Ages was a time of horrid epidemics, as a quick side note, and it killed a great number of people. One of the biggest ones was the plague epidemic in 1348, which had killed two-thirds of Europe's population. People are often then starting to think about the imminence of death and the briefness of life, the brevity. Their perception of death as the grand reaper that scythes people's lives dates from that time. The perception of death as the grand or grim reaper that scythes people's lives, scything lives. So the old characterization you see on Family Guy, for instance, it's become so stereotypical that it's permeated its way all the way into modern times, and it's still very widely known, even in especially around the holidays, is the skeletal figure with a scythe or some other thing that simply walks up and grabs the arm of the soon-to-be faded, ill-fated individual and walks right away with them. And many of these pictures were actually drawn around the mid to late 1300s, 14th century, that was so infused with the idea of death because it was so relevant. Different ideas of death are formed right now, which are taking us back into the 1300s, as if today were then, which were then carried over into, of course, art, out of a rich iconography of death. The picturesque dance of death was perhaps the most well-known in art. Portraits of this theme represented both the clergy and the secular class, which, such as the Pope, a cardinal, a bishop, and an emperor, a king, to be the more secular side of that argument. And even a doctor, a salesman, a child, and the dead are shown as skeletons and rotting corpses, and they're often carrying musical instruments, which is interesting in itself, so. Well, that's a whole rabbit hole. It's a heart of darkness we could spiral into. Get back to Norway, which was, of course, is a part of Europe. So, of course, it was affected by that extremely historically impactful disease, plague, I guess is the best word. Population, as we were saying, expanded in Norway quickly right up until the most pertinent of plague epidemics in 1348-49. Oslo had a population of 3,000. Bergen was 7,000. And Trondheim was 4,000. When it was halved by the Black Death and successive plagues, Bergen became the main trading port controlled by the Hanseatic League, and Norway entered the Kalmar Union with Denmark and Sweden in 1397. So that's where I'm going to stop. And just randomly, for no reason, just going to click something here and then go to another place in our book of Norse mythology and history. So, yeah, it was this page. Creation of Thor's hammer. Make sure you get the book there. One day Loki, the trickster, found himself in an especially mischievous mood when he cut off the gorgeous golden hair of Sif, the wife when Thor learned of this, his quick temper was enraged, and he seized Loki and threatened to break every bone in his body. Loki pleaded with the Thunder God to let him go down to Svartalheim, the cavernous home of the dwarves, to see if those master craftspeople could fashion a new head of hair for Sif, this one even more beautiful than the original. So, naturally, Thor did allow it, and off Loki went to Svartalheim. Loki went to Svartalheim. New series on YouTube, Loki Goes to Svartalheim. And there he was able to obtain what he desired. The sons of the dwarves, Ivaldi, forged not only a new head of hair for Sif, but also two other marvels. Skidbaldir, assembled from thin pieces of wood, the best of all ships, which always has a favorable wind, and can be folded up and put into one's pocket. And Gungir, which means swaying, the deadliest of all spears. Having accomplished this task, Loki was overcome by an urge to remain in the caves of the dwarves and revel in more recklessness. He approached the brothers Broker and Sindri, the metalworker and spark sprayer, respectively, and taunted them. Saying that he was sure the brothers could never forge three new creations equal to those the sons of Ivaldi had just fashioned. In fact, he even bent his head on the lack of their ability. So Broker and Sindri, however, accepted the wager. As they worked, a fly, who of course was none other than Loki himself, in disguise, of course, stung Sindri's hand. And when the dwarf pulled his creation out of the fire, it was a living boar with golden hair. And this was Cullen's Bursti, golden bristled, who gave off light in the dark and could run better than any horse, even through water or air. Sindri then set another piece of gold on the fire as Broker worked the bellows. The fly bit Broker on the neck, and Sindri drew out a magnificent ring, Draupnir, or Dripper. From this ring, every ninth night fall 8 new golden rings of equal weight. Sindri then put the iron on the hearth, and told Broker that this next working, they must be especially meticulous, for a mistake would be more costly than with the previous two projects. Loki immediately stung Broker's eyelid, and the blood blocked the dwarf's eyes, preventing him from properly seeing his work. Sindri produced a hammer of unsurpassed quality, which never missed its mark and would boomerang back to its owner after being thrown. But it had one flaw. The handle was short. Sindri lamented this, that this had almost ruined the peace, which was called Mjolnir, which means lightning. Nevertheless, sure of the great worth of their three treasures, Sindri and Brokkr made their way to Asgard to claim the wages that were due them. Loki made it to the halls of the gods before the dwarves and presented the marvels he had acquired. To Thor he gave Sif's new hair and the hammer of Mjolnir. To Odin went the ring of Draupnir and the spear of Gungnir. And Freyr was the happy recipient of Skidbladnir and Gullinbursnir. As grateful as the gods were to receive these gifts, especially Mjolnir, which they foresaw would be of inestimable help in their battles against the giants, they nevertheless concluded that Loki still owed the dwarves his head. When the dwarves approached Loki with the knives, the cunning god pointed out that he had promised them his head, but not his neck. Brokkr and Sindri contented themselves with sewing Loki's mouth shut and returned to their forge. And that's the end. Of all my Patreons in the back of my book here. Let me see if I can find it. Yeah, here we go. So we have Alan Teeter, we have Alexander Arroyo, we have Andy, Antoine, we have Dale, Debbie, Dylan, Ella, Gregory, Eric, Hardyaka, and Scrappy, of course, Joshua, Justine Bell, thank you so much for your recent donation, Justine, Cameron, Katie McHale, and thank you so much for reaching out to me, Katie, seriously, it really brightened my day when you did, and Kieran Cox, Mark Cohn, Matthias Feiberg, Nick Toombs, Potato Launch, and Richard. Thanks, man. Sean and Simon and Xander. You guys are all awesome. I don't know why I always do that. Like, but you guys really keep me going. You guys keep this channel going. You are the backbone. You guys are the foundation upon which all the feedback and likes and comments and subs are built. And every time I go to make a new video, I think about you guys and the fact that you appreciate my content enough to support the channel and donate, and it really is a really, really good feeling. It makes me know that I'm pursuing a goal that's worthwhile, and without you, I definitely wouldn't be doing this anymore, so. Close the book on this episode and wish you all a deep, restful, refreshing